So good evening. I'm Judith Friedlander, professor of anthropology and former dean of arts and sciences here at Hunter College, and it gives me great pleasure to welcome you this evening to Roosevelt House to listen to our colleagues Nancy Foner and Phil Kasinitz converse with New York Times columnist Sam Roberts about immigrant New York in the 21st century. The subject of Nancy Foner's latest edited collection of essays that bears the wonderful title, One Out of Three. Phil Kasinitz is the co-author of the last chapter in the book, which looks at the children of these immigrants. For those of us who have been following Nancy Foner's work for a long time, we were happy to see that Sam Roberts wrote a nice piece in the Times about One Out of Three shortly after it came out. Nancy Foner is the author of many highly regarded books on immigration in New York, including From Ellis Island to JFK, an historical comparison of the two great waves of immigration in the city in the late 19th, early 20th century, and 100 years later. Phil Kasinitz has also written extensively on the subject, focusing in particular in recent years on the next generation. His most recent book is The Children of Immigrants Come of Age, which he co-authored with Mary Waters, John Mollenkopf, and Jennifer Holliday. But Nancy and Phil, both Nancy and Phil teach at Hunter and the Graduate Center and have taken part in a special honors seminar here in the college on immigration called The Peopling of New York that our Macaulay Honors College students take in their freshman year. Having played a role in recruiting Phil and Nancy to Hunter while I was dean, I take particular pride in hosting the event this evening. Even though Phil is now based full-time at the Graduate Center, and Nancy spends a lot of time there as well, they both remain faithful members of the Hunter College community and giving generously of their time, providing us with opportunities like this one to share in their success as well. It is a great honor for all of us at Hunter to welcome Sam Roberts. As many of you know, in addition to writing regularly for the New York Times, he is author of many books, including most recently Grand Central, How a Train Station Transformed a Nation, on the occasion of the station's centennial. Sam also hosts the New York Times close-up on New York One and appears frequently on NPR. This evening's discussion is part of an ongoing series here at Roosevelt House that is looking at the changing landscape in New York as the city prepares itself for new leadership for the first time in 12 years. We have left copies of the upcoming programs on your chairs and look forward to seeing you again at other conversations in the series like this one and at many other public events that we hold at Roosevelt House throughout the year. Now, before I turn the microphone over to Sam Roberts, I would like to say a few words about the significance of the discussion tonight for Hunter College. In her introduction to One Out of Three, Nancy Foner says that immigrants have not only been influenced by social, economic, and political forces in New York City, but are also agents of change in their new environment. We have witnessed this firsthand at Hunter. Nancy tells us that 37% of the people in New York today are immigrants. And if we add their American-born children, the percentage rises to 55. How does Hunter College reflect the overall population in New York? Our base data focus on the freshman and transfer classes. In 2012, Hunter College enrolled 23,004 students, of whom 18,095 were entering freshmen, and 95 were freshmen, and 1,856 were new transfer students. At least 24.7% of the entering freshman class and 35.1% of our transfer students in 2012 were born outside the U.S. This is really an approximate number because a percentage because 11% of our entering freshmen and 16% of our entering transfers did not answer the question about their origin of birth on the form that they were asked to fill out. Taking it at its value, it is still a little bit lower than that for entire all of CUNY. According to the City University of New York website, 40% of CUNY's population was born outside the mainland of the U.S. In other words, CUNY's figures include those born in Puerto Rico, and I presume Hawaii. In a curious reversal, we know that in 2012, not many from Hawaii, but let's be real, okay. In a curious reversal, we also know that in 2012, 52.8% of Hunters entering freshman class, but only 37.8% of our new transfer students speak a language other than English at home. As for the languages, which languages they are, they check the website, they're all there. Our records indicate that we speak over 64 languages here at Hunter. Clearly, I repeat, the subject of this evening's conversation is of direct interest to all of us who study, teach, and help run this extraordinary institution. The subject, however, is not a new one. From its founding, Hunter College has always represented immigrant New York and the academic aspirations of the next generation. The college was founded in 1870 by an Irish immigrant schoolteacher by the name of Thomas Hunter, an outspoken nationalist who was forced to flee Ireland in 1849 after publishing an article that called for the disestablishment of the Church of England. In New York, he advocated for educational reform and eventually persuaded the city to let him open a normal school to train young women to teach primary school. In florid prose, Hunter explained that his students, who included African Americans, also quite unique for the time, and immigrants from all over Europe, deserved an education as rigorous as the one students received at the École Normale Supérieure, which he reminded his readers was created by Napoleon after the French Revolution. By 1886, Hunter proudly announced in his annual report, "We have Jews and Gentiles and children of almost every European nationality, dark-skinned Negroes sitting beside fair-haired Scandinavians. This is the true democratic mingling of the classes which could only exist in a Republican," lowercase, "country like the United States." Despite Thomas Hunter's uplifting description of his adopted country, racial segregation, of course, and other forms of discrimination were common practice at the time and remained a problem well into the first half of the 20th century, preventing African Americans and other racial ethnic minorities from attending many of the best universities in the country. City College and Hunter College were rare exceptions to the rule, and they graduated a remarkable number of gifted young people from excluded groups who went on subsequently to make major contributions to American society. During the 1930s and 1940s, Hunter's alumni included the African-American civil rights activist and lawyer Pauli Murray, and two women who went on to become Nobel Prize laureates in medicine, both from East European immigrant homes, Gertrude Elion and Rosalind Yalow. To this day, the college remains the only institution of higher learning in the country that can count two female Nobel laureates among its graduates. The list of alumni from those years included as well the writer Bell Kaufman, granddaughter of Sholem Aleichem, African-American dancer and choreographer Pearl Primus, and actress Ruby Dee, Congresswoman Bella Abzug, and opera singer Regina Rebznik, among many others. And the story continues to the present day, with gifted children of immigrants from Africa, Asia, Latin America, as well as new waves of immigrants from Europe. So with that, let me turn the microphone over to Sam Roberts and enjoy the evening.
Thank you, Judy, and thanks to all of you for coming tonight. And also thanks, of course, to our panelists, Nancy Foner, Phil Kasinitz. Let me just say, I'm going to speak ever so briefly, then I'm going to throw it open to questions to our panel, then questions from the audience, and then afterward, Nancy Foner will be upstairs signing copies of her book graciously for us. A couple of years ago, when the census said that the United States was going to reach 300 million people, I went to a friend of mine who worked for the city's health department and said, find me someone who is going to be born at that precise moment. one of those things that statisticians love at 7:46 in the morning on October 9th, we are going to hit 300 million people. Well, sure enough, at Elmhurst Hospital in Queens, they found someone, Emmanuel Plata, His parents were Mexican immigrants. I'm not sure if they were documented or not. And he was born there. His father worked in a restaurant in Queens. The doctor was from Argentina. One of the nurses was from Russia. The other was from India. And the anesthesiologist was from Bulgaria. And if this isn't a New York story, I don't know what is. We talk about immigration in this election year and what the consequences of it are for the election, what the implications will be for the next mayor. Well, to me, the surest sign of political clout in this town is how effective you are at persuading the city council to eliminate alternate side parking on some ethnic or religious holiday. Well, in addition to all those Jewish, Christian, national holidays, you don't have to move your car on the Asian Lunar New Year, the Hindu Festival of Lights, and six Muslim holy days. I mean, that is political power in New York, I think, and a very important thing to remember. Another thing that we have here that seems unique to New York, when I looked up the number one name among newborn baby boys in Texas, all of Texas, the number one most popular name is Jose. Probably not all that surprising given the Hispanic birth rate. In New York, when you look up the most common name among babies, the most popular names, among Hispanic babies, among males, the most popular name is not Jose, it is Jaden. The most popular names among Asian newborns in New York are Sophia and Ethan. This is a sign of something different in this town, and I think it's a very interesting thing and a very lucky thing that what we're seeing here is ultimately going to be mirrored around the United States. Now, Nancy Foner has written a book, One Out of Three. What she didn't tell you is that she once almost wrote a book, One Out of Six. Things have changed since then, and that's what I'd like to begin by asking. What is new in immigration in New York? We have always been an immigrant city. We reached a low point in immigration around 1970, and then have been working our way up ever since. We are now approaching the 20th century high of about 40%. What is different in the new waves of immigration that have come to New York?
I'm going to start here. Okay. Well, I mean, everything is new, you'd say, right? I thought I'd start just by, this I think emphasizes what's new, with a book that most of you have read, you know, Beyond the Melting Pot, which was published in 1963, and then the revised edition came out in 1970. And that book, the classic book, focused on five groups in New York: Jews, Italians, the Irish, quote, Negroes, and Puerto Ricans. Now, saying that now in 2010, that sounds like ancient history. It's not that long ago, really, right? New York has been transformed by immigration. It's continually transformed and remade. Clearly, it's very different from 1960 and 1970. It's obviously very different from 100 years ago, which I've written about. But to also give you sort of a flavor and set the stage, I think also to think about just some statistics looking at 1980 versus 2010. Because in 1980, Asians were 3% of the population in New York. In 2010, they're 13%. Asian no longer means Chinese in New York. Chinese are a big chunk of the Asian population, but it also means Indian, Filipino, Pakistani, Bangladeshi, and other groups. Hispanics in 1980 were 20% of New York City's population. They're now 29%, and Hispanic no longer means Puerto Rican. In fact, the word Hispanic wasn't even used. It was Puerto Rican, right? And now, Dominicans are the largest immigrant group in New York City. Mexicans, who we will be talking about, are now the third largest immigrant group in New York. Also in the top 10 are Ecuadorians. There's also Colombians, very large numbers. Blacks, non-Hispanic blacks, were 24% of the population in 1980. But in 2010, they're 23%. So you can say, well, that's the same. Well, actually, one thing is, there would not be such a large black population in New York if there was not immigration. Plus, the black population has been increasingly Caribbeanized and Africanized. A third of the black population is foreign-born, and that's just foreign-born, not the second generation that we'll hear Phil talking about. And I should say, by the way, just to add, the Asian population now is 75% foreign-born, and the Hispanic population is about a half foreign-born. And finally, the non-Hispanic white population, which in 1980 was 52%, is now 33%. Although, again, and this makes New York special, the white population is about a quarter foreign-born. And we might be also talking later about ways in which New York is special, because all of those four ethno-racial groups in New York that make up the city today have a high percentage of foreign-born. So, I mean, that is one way, I mean, that begins to set the stage. Also, I think, just to, again, New York stands out, and if we look at New York's immigrant population, for its remarkable diversity. It wasn't so diverse in the past 100 years ago. It was Jews and Italians, mainly, who were coming to New York in the last great wave of immigration. But today, it's remarkably diverse. No one, two, three, and you can go four, five, six, groups dominate the immigrant population. The top three groups in New York and the immigrant groups are Dominicans, Chinese, and Mexicans. And they are about 30% of the immigrant population. That, put in national perspective, is very different. Mexicans are 30% of the immigrant population in the United States. In many cities, and you can read the book, a wonderful chapter by Peter Lobo and Joe Salvo, has a wonderful chart in which a figure in which they show the Mexican population in Houston, Los Angeles, Chicago, and New York. And in the other three cities, Mexicans are 35 to a little over 45% of the immigrant population. Mexicans may be number three in New York, but they are 6% of the immigrant population. So no one group is dominating the immigrant population. And at the same time, again, to emphasize, every racial ethnic group of the four major ones has a fairly high percentage of immigrants. So I don't know, to set the stage a little bit in terms of providing a view of the immigrant population, I think we can talk what's new, because the book is also concerned about what's new in the last 10, 20 years. Because maybe I should just give, and then I can pass it over to Phil, but just say one thing. For example, we think about the post-65 immigration, and we say, oh, you know, Dominican Washington Heights. I do this too. There's Dominican Washington Heights, there's West Indian Central Brooklyn, there are the three Chinatowns. But just to give you a little taste of some of the newness, more Dominicans live in the Bronx than in Manhattan now. Yeah. More Chinese live in Queens and Brooklyn than in Chinatown. So there's been definitely changes. One of the chapters in the book is about little Liberia. Now, Liberians are a small group, but you know, there are a lot of new small groups. Liberians, there's a community in Staten Island. Staten Island, which we think of as a white borough, is a fifth foreign born. Liberians are living on the North Shore of Staten Island, have created a little Liberia with an African market. You know, there are endless ways in which immigrants have been changing the neighborhoods, changing the economy, changing the foods we eat, changing the politics, which we'll get into. All things that I think we should be discussing and will be discussing.
One of the things I found fascinating is I did a story not long ago about linguistic diversity in New York. And it turns out there are some parts of New York where languages are spoken more frequently than they are spoken back in the old country. There's a language called Vlaški, which is a Croatian dialect, which is spoken more in Queens than it is back in Croatia, because half the people emigrated here still speak the language in their sort of insular group, whereas in Croatia they have become overrun by other ethnic groups, by other nationalistic groups, and therefore the language is rapidly disappearing, whereas we still have it here. Phil, I'd like to ask you, have written particularly about the Caribbean immigrants in this city. What are the implications of a much more diverse black population in this city, both from the Caribbean and from Africa, than mostly American-born or Southern-born blacks?
Well,
or even Caribbean-born
blacks. Right. I think that one of the things, again, we get into what makes New York distinct in terms of this, is that in most parts of the country, the question of immigrants versus natives sort of maps onto large ethno-racial categories. So in Los Angeles, people talk a lot about brown-black conflict, for example. And again, one of the, to reiterate something Nancy pointed out, interesting things here is obviously immigration means a huge growth in the Latino and the Asian population, but a third of the black population is foreign-born, and something like a quarter of the white population is foreign-born. So it's not a dis... And I think in some ways that has meant that the immigrant versus native issue has not had the kind of racial polarization behind it that it's had in other places. Because a fair amount of the African-American population, just to take that attitude, being immigrant, living in communities where there are lots of immigrants, tends not to see, although there is, one of the funny things about New York is that we like to, in a gee-whizzery way, talk about how incredibly diverse we are, as if like tolerance then exudes. And as all of us know, that doesn't necessarily mean great tolerance for every kind of group all over the world. But to some degree, it means that the stereotypes are so nuanced and so fine that you don't end up having, you know, us versus them in quite the same way. And I think in the case of the African-American population, while at times there have been conflicts with various immigrant groups, immigrants in general are not seen as a threat to the black population in the way they are in some parts of the country, in part because a lot of the blacks are themselves immigrants. Mm-hmm. And I think the other side to this is that it's meant that politically, a large part of the African-American leadership and in many ways, civil rights organizations and civil rights policies have ended up benefiting immigrants as well. And almost without noticing it, many of the organizations that began their lives advocating for the rights of providing services to African Americans, or for that matter, Puerto Ricans, found themselves doing immigrant resettlement services. You know, often without it, theorizing it, thinking about it, but that became part of their mission. And I think in the long run, that's been a unifying factor.
Can I just add, maybe?
Please jump in.
I'm jumping in. I think in terms of another aspect of this, which comes out, I edited another book on West Indians called Islands in the City, and Milton Vickerman, a sociologist, has an interesting piece in there in which he talks about it's possible that the large number of presence of a large number of West Indians in New York, well, he says, tweak notions of blackness, in that the white population and others may become more sensitive to ethnic distinctions within the black community. Mm-hmm. So it won't be this monolithic notion of blackness that now we, you know.
And that's probably even more true of immigration from Africa.
Exactly.
Well, which is growing, by the way. By the, that's a very interesting, because it's now almost 5% of the immigrant population. And if you look at the map and in the figure in Lobo and Salvo's chapter, you can't even see it in 1970. It's so small. So that is, that is a growing population. I think when also raising this, I think makes is something to add here too, is that although New York doesn't have, you know, is not nativism, you know, or, you know, a hostility to foreigners is not something that is, New York is good on that front, right? Including on undocumented and immigrants, and also mayors love immigrants. I mean, this is an immigrant-friendly city in many ways. However, we have to bear in mind, so we don't get too carried away with, you know, this Pollyannish view of New York, right, as Phil was indicating, that we are a city with very, you know, deeply entrenched racial inequalities. And the group that feels it actually the most of the immigrant groups are the black immigrants, mm-hmm, who, you know, we've been hearing a lot about stop and frisk with, you know, Latinos and blacks, right, who are males who are subject to stop and frisk. A lot of them, you know, the police don't say, are you an immigrant,
right,
or not. Plus, one of the things that's really quite astounding about New York is the degree of racial residential segregation when it comes to blacks. When there's a colleague of ours, John Logan, who did a study of the 50 largest metro areas, the 50 metro areas in the country with the largest black populations, New York is number 3 right in segregation, in the level of segregation, right below Detroit and Milwaukee. And so, you know, this is, if 0 is, you know, the least segregation and 100 is the most segregation, people of African ancestry, whether they're from the West Indies or whether they're, you know, their grandchildren, parents came from the American South to New York, are very segregated from from whites.
And that is often regardless of class lines.
Exactly.
That's right.
And when it's interesting, too, because one of the things that I keep referring to Lobo and Salvo, I should refer to other chapters, right? But that's an interesting demographic overview. They have this category of melting pot neighborhoods, which are neighborhoods with whites and two other groups, which would be either Asians, Latinos, and blacks. And they say there are 690 of them in the city, and they're fairly stable, which shows, in fact, this development of these polyethnic neighborhoods that are very diverse. But almost all of them, I should put it another way, almost none of them have blacks in them.
Right.
I mean, that's what's interesting. Yeah. So we still, I mean, so I think, you know, just to, that's an issue that we have to be sensitive.
Well, Phil, why is that? Why are blacks the sort of indelible immigrants in that sense?
Wow. Yeah. Well, I think the interesting question really is when we think about segregation and the measurement of segregation is, as demographers know, is one of those extremely devils in the details kind of exactly what units are you looking at situation that sociologists like to argue about exactly how to measure it. But what we've seen on the one hand is black-white segregation. The proportion of blacks who live in virtually all black neighborhoods is amazingly stable. Okay. And amazingly consistent. On the other hand, the proportion of whites who live in neighborhoods in which at least two other racial groups are present has skyrocketed. So the all-white neighborhood, you know, is, while not totally extinct in New York, is in very rapid decline in New York.
Is that because there are fewer whites to go around?
Partially because there's fewer whites to go around. The white people shortage is a piece of this. And I should note on that, that cuts interestingly by generation. I mean, the residential, in terms of residence, is perhaps the least extreme way of looking at this. If you look at my classes at Hunter College, you know, if you're in your 50s, this still, to some degree, looks like a black-white Puerto Rican city, or with an immigrant city, too, but that's less of the issue. If you're in your 20s in New York today, the people you go to class with, the people that you date, the people you compete for jobs with, the people you go to nightclubs with, being immigrants or the child of immigrants is by far the majority experience. It's the experience that it's modal to the point where other people end up assimilating to that rather than the other way around. As for why...
You're saying we don't go to nightclubs, right?
Well, I should speak for myself, Sam.
He's the older
As for why African Americans, it continues to be true that segregation levels for African Americans and for black immigrants, and in fact, to pick up something that Nancy said before, in some ways, there are ways in which the black ethnic populations are quite distinct from African Americans, in terms of culture, to some degree in terms of where they work. In terms of where they live, less distinct. And probably the thing that's most unifying for the black population today is interaction with whites and interaction with events, things like stop and frisk, which suddenly reduces all that ethnic difference and the class difference to race pure and simple, right? And so the anonymous encounter with authorities in a public place has increasingly become kind of a defining feature for many African Americans of what blackness means, you know, and that unifies across these kind of ethnic lines.
One of the things when we talk about diversity in the city and tolerance, I think Nancy is absolutely right. We sometimes make too much of that. I recall doing some stories about the Dutch and the Dutch beginnings of New York, which I think make New York unique. And when you go back there, you find that, you know, what we took for tolerance was really to a great extent indifference. Saying as long as you didn't get in the way of our making money, we would, you know, allow you to be here. We wouldn't mind what you were doing. Of course, there were notable exceptions to that, but it was much more indifference than it was, you know, enlightened tolerance to a great extent. Let me ask about another immigrant group that Nancy has written about, and one we don't normally associate with New York, but one that is becoming more and more important here, and that is Mexicans. Where are they coming from? Why are they coming here? And what are the implications of a group that for the first time is disproportionately undocumented as opposed to many other groups of immigrants who came before them?
Well, they are a new group. Although, interestingly, Rob Smith, who writes the piece on Mexicans, starts out by saying, everyone always calls Mexicans the new kids on the block. They're not so new anymore. But actually, they're new. I mean, in terms of their numbers, they're a newer group in New York. I beg to differ with Rob, even though they have been here in large numbers for a couple of decades. Well, they've been coming here, they've been coming to New York from Puebla heavily, but also from other parts of Mexico. Often, according to him, the legalization, after the IRCA liberated many Mexicans in California in the West Coast to be able to move around because they were legalized. And there's been clearly a high percentage of undocumented Mexicans. Although, let me say again, it is wrong to think that New York's undocumented population is a Mexican only population, or even Mexican mainly. I mean, again, because of the diversity, Mexicans, it's very hard to get figures on this. There was one study that estimated that there were about a quarter of the undocumented population. So there are a lot of other groups with high percentages of undocumented. Clearly the issue, though, a major issue for the Mexican population is legal status. And here, New York is very, is immigrant friendly, it doesn't, ask people, the police don't ask people about their immigrant status. New York City makes, known to people that they can use the municipal public, the hospitals. And that's true, but, New York City doesn't make national policy. And that's the big problem. I mean, the undocumented suffer from, Mexicans and other undocumented that, they in terms of the jobs they can get, in terms of the fact that they're not entitled to emergency Medicaid is pretty much it in terms of what they're entitled to in social benefits. And there's a fear of deportation because there's been so many deportations. And in New York State, those of you who have probably read the newspaper, right, California is ahead of New York State, right, in allowing undocumented now to get driver's licenses. They can't get driver's licenses in New York. So also, the children, we have to think about, in terms of undocumented Mexicans and others, is that it's not just the undocumented themselves, it's also their U.S.-born citizen children, Mexican and otherwise, who are suffering, whose parents, for example, we know from studies that their parents are loath to go to get a lot of, benefits that their children are eligible for, like food stamps or enroll them in preschool programs. So, that is the real issue for the Mexican population, although there is a growing population of U.S.-born citizen Mexicans who are starting to go to school, who are starting to go to CUNY. CUNY, by the way, has a very good outreach program for Mexicans. And they, undocumented immigrants, can get in-state tuition at CUNY and other places, which they often don't know that they can do. And organizations of Mexicans, and actually one in which Rob Smith is involved in, and he's the author of the chapter on Mexicans, is very involved in getting Mexican students to know that they, even if they're undocumented, that they can go to CUNY and pay. First of all, that they can go to CUNY, because a lot of them don't know, they're afraid. And also that they're eligible for in-state tuition.
But roughly but I what do proportion think of Mexicans in New York are undocumented?
We don't really know.
We don't really know. Although, there's every reason to assume that for all groups, the number of undocumented people in New York is lower than it is in most parts of the country. Mm-hmm. Most of the estimates are, 12-15%, probably considerably higher for Mexicans. Mm-hmm. But in general, compared to other places in the U.S., the issue of legal status looms less large simply because more of our immigrants have come into the country mm-hmm. legally. That said, just to sort of underline something that Nancy pointed out, studies increasingly show that there's a fairly large negative effect on having undocumented parents, mm-hmm. even if you are a U.S.-born, U.S. citizen child. Frank Bean, the demographer at UC Irvine, has done fascinating studies mm-hmm. in California of Mexican American children, showing that it really costs about a year of educational attainment, mm-hmm. to have undocumented parents among U.S. citizen children. And this is the kind of thing that, again, we point out the access to benefits. The mere fact that your parents might never want to attend the PTA meeting because, or be involved or be visible at all. This is really having a long-term effect, and again, to cite Rob Smith's piece, there really does seem to be starting to be a really quite dramatic difference between the outcomes for Mexican-American kids whose parents were legalized and who've been legal, and their siblings for whom that hasn't happened, or the cousins for whom that hasn't happened, people who are similar in every other way, but legal status. Legal status is really kind of the civil rights movement of this moment, in terms of, I don't think we've had since the end of Jim Crow such a large population of political unpersons who are permanently domiciled in the United States, part of the society in every meaningful way, except in that all-important citizenship question, except in that question of political status. And it's an issue that we haven't faced in a while.
Nancy. Let me just to give the, I don't think I gave the figure, right? The estimate, right? That again, the demographers in the book say that there are 500,000 undocumented immigrants in New York. So that is a 1 in 6. 1 in 6 of the immigrants are undocumented, which may be one reason why it's not such a big issue in New York. Most undocumented immigrants in New York are visa overstayers. They haven't been smuggled across the border, which is, you know, different from the United, you know, the country. And as I said, you know, they're in many different groups. So you know, if you think about one, it's always, you know, it's a head, 1 out of 6 is undocumented, but 5 out of 6, right. So most of the immigrants are here legally.
It's one of these ironies that if you listen to the politics of this, I mean, 1 out of 6 undocumented is an enormous number.
But
on the other hand, if you listen to our politicians, you'd assume it was like 7 out of 10, right? Similarly, you know, the number of, a third of all immigrants in the United States are Mexican, which is an enormous number for one country. But if you were to listen to the politics, you'd assume it was 95%.
Well, but in the country as a whole, it's 1 out of 4.
Right.
So it's higher.
It's higher elsewhere than it is in New York.
Well,
right,
yes,
of course.
And nationally, yes. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's what, 11.7 is the latest, million is the latest figure out of 40, so that's a quarter. It's more than, nationally, the figure is bigger. And, you know, in the Southwest in California, the places near the border, and which have had longer, you know, Mexican populations. And it is associated in the Southwest in California with Mexicans in a way that it is not associated with Mexicans here. And in fact, there was an interesting analysis about why, when there were the protests, or those big marches a number of years ago, you know, in favor of legislation, they were huge in Los Angeles, huge, and not very big here.
Right.
And one explanation was is that there in California or Los Angeles, they were pitched, they could be pitched very to one group, the Mexicans, and they were organized that way, which in New York it was harder to organize undocumented because they were, you know, in different groups.
Phil, you mentioned politics, which was my segue.
Yes.
Did we see any influence of immigrants in the politics of this mayoral election so far?
Well, what we don't have good figures on is how many immigrants voted. Do you have figures?
No, I have John Mullenkopf's projection about how many there will be in the mayor election. He says 1 out of 3 voters will be an immigrant in the mayor election.
In November.
Yeah,
that's what
November.
He says.
Really?
But of course, again, because I think except on issues that directly involve the immigration immigration itself, immigrants rarely see themselves politically as immigrants per se. They're much more likely to identify with their particular ethnic group. So it hasn't had the immigrants vote for this, except when it ends up being issues that are directly tied to immigration. And since, you know, New York mayoral candidates left, right, and center tend to be reasonably pro-immigrant, it hasn't come up in quite that way. I do think that, maybe I'm going out on a limb here, but it does seem to me that the de Blasio campaign sort of emphasizes a kind of Obama-like post-racial Brooklyn mentality that is sort of, I think, very appealing for people who do not feel that the old racial categories fit them.
It's interesting. I wrote a story for the Times on
yes,
whether
I
we are,
that.
know, in a post-racial period. And then I realized we are not beyond identity politics. That Bill de Blasio had very effectively hijacked several identities at the same time.
But, you know, I think this gets into what's new. Right. I think one of the things that's new, well, first of all, obviously, you know, the groups being appealed to, it's no longer the three I's, you know, Italy, Ireland, and Israel. But also, if you look, right, that politicians appeal to. Also, just as backdrop, before I get into some figures, I'm a qualitative, I'm an anthropologist.
I'm very impressed with all
the numbers.
All the numbers,
I know. That's from editing all these books. I'm very up on my numbers. In 1990, the city council in New York had no immigrants or second generation members.
Right.
In 2009, there were nine, and we know there are going to be more in 2014. So what's happening, one, is that immigrants are electing their own, or not always, it's not always their own, and sometimes it's their own. And that gets to the next question, is that groups, particularly at the mayor level or the congressional level, even at the city council level in many cases, because of this diversity, you know, have to appeal. They've got to make alliances. Right. In fact, I think you were writing about that in your story. Exactly. They have to make alliances across these groups. They cannot just rely on, for example, Grace Meng, who is the first Asian American congresswoman who was elected in 2012 in Queens. She could not just rely on the Chinese ethnic vote. She wouldn't have gotten elected. She had, if you see this campaign picture, you know, you see all different groups there. I mean, she had to make many, as did John Liu, to become the controller in 2009. In fact, the one person who probably didn't have to make as many of these alliances, although she had to make some, probably, was Yvette Clark, and that who was running in Central Brooklyn because of residential segregation. She was running in a pretty much black. She had to make links with African Americans. Yes,
with Haitians
and Haitians. So there was some. Yeah. It wasn't as broad alliances, but I think that's one of the tricky things, that's happening with New York politics now. As a result of the, and if in fact immigrants are one out of three voters, remember, that's immigrants, that's not the children of immigrants. Right. So that means that the children of immigrants and immigrants are a large proportion of the voters. So, you know, that changes electoral calculus.
Could we not talk about the black vote anymore, or the Puerto Rican vote, or the Hispanic vote, or the Jewish vote?
It depends on, it depends on, for example, the black vote is a black vote if it's at a higher level, you know, and there's no candidate, a West Indian is not running against an African American versus an African, right?
But the black vote went to the white guy with the black son rather than to the black candidate.
That's
interesting.
But if you have a local election, which an African American is running against a West Indian, then there'll be a split. So I mean,
or inter-Hispanic. I mean, you had a Mexican defeating a Puerto Rican councilman in Central Brooklyn.
Right.
So in some ways, you get this irony where the larger categories kind of work at the mayoral level, but we can get down to the congressional level, they look different. When you get down to the council level, they look even more minute in terms of the various kinds of people who are running.
Are there implications for governing for the next mayor in this equation? Bill Keller in the Times had a piece yesterday about the difference between campaigning and governing. Mario Cuomo used to talk about the fact that politics was poetry and governing was prose. You know, a nice way of putting it, but what are the consequences of these changes for the next mayor?
Well, I think that there are just a number of issues. It's funny, in New York, we rarely think of it as immigration issues per se, or immigrant issues per se, but the schools are facing, you know, because of all those languages everyone speaks, that makes the teaching of English as a second language a much bigger issue here. Mm-hmm. And by the way, it undermined traditional bilingual education because you can't run bilingual classes anymore when you have 17 languages, you know, and none of whom have more than, you know, 20% of your students. So in some ways, that educational policy shift, largely from traditional bilingual to ESL, happened without people actually articulating why or reasons. It just sort of happened on the ground as people were adjusting to what was going on. Certainly policing, you know, similarly is facing different kinds of diversity, often, again, without really thinking it through. Certainly issues of healthcare. So I think that, you know, in many ways there are immigrant-specific issues. Social services, various communities are always going to address that. But since the immigrants are so much of the city, maybe they're just the issues of being New Yorkers or being at least working-class, non-wealthy New Yorkers. And outside of Manhattan, south of 96th Street, you know, that's the city.
That's
well,
it.
One issue, I think I agree. I agree with Phil, right?
As
I
well
think,
you should.
Right. However, one issue that might come up, that almost came up recently, was this issue of non-citizen voting.
Right.
And I don't know what de Blasio, I mean, it was proposed in the city council. You know, we don't have none. You have to be a citizen in New York to vote. Well, there are some small cities in the U.S. where that's not true. And Amsterdam, this is why I was so interested in it, because I'm editing a book on New York and Amsterdam. Amsterdam has non-citizen voting in local elections and has had that for a long time. Actually, there are a lot of European cities that do, but we don't in New York. No big major gateway city in the United States has that. But it was proposed in the city council. Sure. But it was never brought up by Quinn. She didn't let it come up. So then the question is, because that would obviously change electoral calculus in city elections, right? So I don't know, a question mark.
Well, how would it change it?
Well, a lot more people would be voting, right, and who are immigrants.
Or at least would be eligible to be voting.
Well, and they would undoubtedly, you'd get more.
They wouldn't have voted in the public advocate runoff necessarily.
<Yeah, well. laughs> So I don't know. I just throw that out.
It might really change the age structure of the electorate a little bit, which is, again, I think what I'm fascinated by is the extent to which any of these like issues of immigrant and native cross cut so dramatically by age group. And it, you know, our electorate is a lot older and a lot wider than our population at the moment.
But we are seeing problems that other studies have brought up about older immigrants. And problems that they're facing, both language problems and problems about being undocumented as well.
Yeah. Well, there'll be an age. There'll be growing number of older immigrants.
Right.
True.
Right.
But again, and also a growing. We haven't really talked about the second generation, right? The second generation growing up, right, and moving into the workforce and into New York. But also remember, if we're looking ahead, I don't know if we're getting to the point of looking ahead. But if we're looking ahead. Remember, I mean, we have all these dynamics going on. We have continued immigration,
right,
because there's no sign that the United States is going to clamp down and lower the numbers of immigrants coming. In fact, anything, the legislation that's been out there is actually going to increase the numbers. And the United States allows in a million or more immigrants every year. And a significant proportion of them come to New York, if only because they've got relatives and friends here and there's still work. And so you have a kind of dynamic situation constantly going. So if I wrote, you know, one out of three, I mean, I don't think, it's not going to keep going up. But you have, you know, we'll be having new immigrants coming into the city at the same time as we have a second and a third generation going. And these non-Hispanic whites getting older and older. And, you know, so I think that, you know, it's an ongoing dynamic.
But I'm thinking with that it's, you know, to some degree, there's a nostalgic discourse in New York that likes to say, the present is like, in fact, today is more like the early 20th century than it was like the bad old days of the 70s, 60s, and 70s. And I think we take a lot of comfort in that in New York, you know, because immigrant incorporation is something that we sort of have a self-congratulatory myth that says we did that pretty well, you know, versus some of the problems of the 60s and 70s, we didn't resolve all that well. So I think we take a certain comfort. But one of the ways in which the current situation really is dramatically different is that there was a very long hiatus in immigration. By and large, immigration to the city, while it doesn't come to a grinding halt, reduces very dramatically between the mid-1920s and the mid-1960s. So you really have a generation. I mean, in the Brownsville in which my father grew up in the 1940s, everybody over the age of 40 had an accent. And nobody under the age of 20 did.
But nobody knew they did.
Yeah, nobody knew they did. So by the time I was growing up in the 1960s, You know, nobody my parents' age had an accent, and everybody my grandparents' age had an accent. And I just assumed that you got an accent when you got older. which is actually happening, much to my chagrin. But there was a real sense in which generation mapped onto, you know, being first, second, third generation and chronological age sort of were in lockstep. We tend to forget that's just the historical unique situation, an idiosyncrasy of the way in which immigration law happened, and it's not happening today. So, you know, in a high school classroom today, you will have second generation, third generation, people who were born abroad but have lived here their whole lives, people who were born here but then went back and then came back, and people who got here yesterday. And they're all talking to each other and mixing with each other. So that kind of ethnic replenishment, I think, is probably making some of the predictions that we would base on the previous experience not perhaps quite as accurate. Yeah.
Because we're not sure how much is being replenished and what the multitude of that is and where they're all coming from.
Exactly.
I think also it leads to a lot of misperceptions. And you talked about language, you know, before. I mean, one thing we do know from the sociological literature is that you know, we know about language assimilation, that the the first generation comes, you know, as adults speaking the home country language. They learn English to some degree. The second generation learns English, but often keeps the home country language, particularly to talk to their parents. And by the third generation, the majority are monolingual English.
I have to, though, just jump on this for one, only because the politics of this is on one. We don't get many findings in the social sciences that we can completely 100% nail and write. The acquisition of English by U.S.-born children of immigrants is universal. And there are very few social scientific findings that are that consistent. And they have done studies in New York and in San Diego and Miami. That one we got right. Let's, you know, some people are retaining native languages more than others. Okay. But the notion that there's some horrible problem because we've raised the generation of people who are not going to be able to speak English
is wrong.
It's just, I mean, they may be poorly educated because they went to our schools, but
they speak English.
But they speak English, and there's a lot of social sciences that pretty much has that one down.
Okay, so we've got three generation linguistic assimilation, which is you know, a finding that happened in the past. It happens now, even though many people think, and I've heard this over and over, you know, that that's not happening. But what often people don't realize, if they see young people, for example, speaking Spanish on the street or whatever, is that they just came here. They weren't born here. So that you, because remember that there's people immigrating. It's not just that everyone immigrates, you know, when they're 25. They come at different ages. And so they're, you know, they're coming with their languages. And so if you see young people speaking a foreign language, it could be that they're newcomers. And I think that that's, I think that's important to remember. It's also, by the way, important to remember that in the past, immigrants didn't learn English, you know, in 2 months. Right. I've had many people over
on the boat on the way over.
My grandparents, they spoke English, and they're not speaking English today, but they didn't speak it that well in the past.
Because you didn't know your grandparents when they were 22.
Right. So but that is actually one of the similarities between then and
Well, that's what I want to, before we turn to questions from the audience, go to that point, because it's something that always fascinated me. You talk about the self-congratulatory perception of how we handled immigrants back then. We now are once again approaching that sort of magic 40% figure of foreign born in New York. What's different this time?
Well, my goodness, everything is different. I mean, the groups are different. New York is different. I mean, there's just so many things that are different. I think in terms of myths, there are so many myths. I mean, one myth is that, you know, my son, the doctor myth, right? I mean, because that's often held, right? And the idea that, you know, especially among Jews, that, you know, right away they came here and their children did so well. They went to college. They became lawyers. They became doctors. That really is a myth. It was mostly my grandson, the dog.
I bet say that's less a myth than a telescoping of history.
Yeah, well,
because it did happen.
It took considerably longer
than we tend to remember.
And actually, one of the things about today's immigration is that there's a much higher percent of immigrants who are coming with high levels of education. I mean, over a quarter of the immigrants in New York have a college degree or more. Mm-hmm. And that was nothing, even given that the structure of education is different in the past. I mean, certainly, you know, the Italians came, many of them were not even literate in Italian. I mean, they were laborers, the Jews also, you know, they were not high, they had some were skilled workers, but they, you know, nothing like what we see today.
Right.
So actually a higher percentage of immigrants today are coming with greater skills.
I looked at the Stuyvesant High School yearbook the other day, and it's absolutely fascinating what proportion of Asian kids are attending.
Well, yes.
But that also, you know, in terms of what we have to think about, I think, of the future of the city emphasizes something. I mean, there are moments when diversity can actually obscure, deepening inequalities.
Mm-hmm.
So Stuyvesant High School and the Bronx High School of Science and Brooklyn Tech are incredibly diverse now. Mm-hmm. They represent many, many countries. I think there's Asian majorities at both Stuyvesant and Bronx Science. Mm-hmm. You know, a very healthy. The number of blacks of any ethnicity in those schools has plummeted in recent years. And the number of native African Americans, which was never that high, become virtually none. And this is a real issue, I think, for the future of the city. I mean, to some extent, I started out studying second generation immigrants really out of a concern of a lot of people that there was sort of a melting into a largely African American underclass, that there was downward assimilation. I think I ended up far more convinced that the real problem was that the relative success of a lot of the children of immigrants, including those of groups we think of as of color, is actually obscuring some real crises that are happening in some of the long-time Latino and African-American communities. Sure. And the celebration of diversity can obscure that.
I think also, just to add another note here, about New York, we're talking about immigrants, we're talking about race, and of course, you know, the big issues in New York is, you know, class and economic inequality in this city. And so you have this situation where you have these immigrants coming into, you know, one of the most unequal cities in class terms in the nation, maybe in the world, you know, and I think that's of course something, it's always been very unequal in New York. I mean, there's always been class inequality, but clearly coming into New York now, and you know, what that means for immigrants. I mean, that's, you know, and again, what that means for everybody, because increasingly, I think, and the, you know, the issue of these social issues are really issues not just for immigrants; they're issues for all New Yorkers, and you know, and they're not just issues, immigrant issues.
Let's take some questions from the audience, Jack.
Are immigrants?
Here comes a mic.
Oh.
Are immigrants of different status eligible for Obamacare? And if they are, isn't that a good thing for the national interest?
Do you mean the undocumented immigrants are eligible for Obamacare? They're not.
Non-citizens.
They're not. Undocumented.
Illegal permanent residents.
What? Yeah,
legal
you have to. Legal permanent residents are, but undocumented are not.
Okay, but to the extent that legal immigrants are eligible, they also tend to be younger, healthier, and when they pay, if they adopt it and they pay their premiums, isn't that good for the pool?
Theoretically, yeah.
Well,
of all the arguments pro and con,
that was not
Obamacare,
that would
that's
not
probably
be,
not the one that's going to win the day. But but I do think.
But it's another good one.
Yeah, it's another good one. Well, I think though that one of the things that your question brings up though is the fact that unlike some other parts of the country, the undocumented population or even the legal permanent resident population really isn't a distinct population from other immigrants in general. I mean, throughout the U.S., but particularly in New York, you have an awful lot of mixed status families where, you know, you will have U.S. citizens, legal permanent residents, people who are in ambiguous statuses that may or may not be on the road to some legal permanent residence, and outright illegals, all in the same family. Yeah. And as a result, you know, whose legal status who and who qualifies for what program gets very complicated, and therefore problems for non-citizens and problems for undocumented people are not just problems for them, they're problems for all the people who are in their families.
Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Hi. I wanted to ask, on the street, it seems Harlem is becoming less black and El Barrio is becoming less Puerto Rican. To the extent that the economy has an impact on the access to housing, how are neighborhoods ethnically changing? Are they becoming, are they solidifying within ethnic groups, or are we seeing ethnic group sort of thinning out?
Well, there's, I mean, the neighborhoods that are, you're talking about gentrification in some of these areas, right? Yeah. Well, I mean, even Dominican, you know, according to Joe Salvo, Dominicans, you know, are being priced out of Washington Heights and moving. That's one of the reasons why they're moving to the Bronx. So to the extent, yes, I mean, there's changing, and changes in the neighborhoods, yes. I mean, East Harlem, although, you know, East Harlem has a lot of crummy housing, and that's not being fixed up, and that's where Mexicans are living, because there's a big Mexican community in East Harlem, so it's...
I would say also that, on the one hand, this is a enormous risky overgeneralization, but I do think that an awful lot of traditionally working class, minority and immigrant neighborhoods towards the middle of the city increasingly are seeing influxes of native whites. And you're seeing both native minorities and immigrants increasingly at outer edges of the city or places that are less convenient to mass transportation. So Harlem, Bed-Stuy have seen big increases in the white populations. And generally more middle class, including more middle class African American populations, where you're seeing more poor people in northern Staten Island. You know, and so that's, you know, in some ways the city is kind of turning inside out a little bit. With
more like a European city.
More like a European city, exactly. Wealthier people in the middle, and both immigrants and native minorities in the outer city, and increasingly the suburbs. Mm-hmm. So in some sense it's becoming looking more like Paris in that sense. I will say, though, the big exception to that that we often forget is there's 500,000 people in public housing in New York City. And they don't go anywhere. You know, they're the stablest population we've got. There's an enormously long waiting list. They have the longest stablest tenancy of any group of people in the city. And that looks like the demography of New York of 40 years ago, just because that's how long ago you had to get on the list to get into public housing. And as a result, the reason East Harlem won't become an entirely white or an entirely Mexican neighborhood anytime soon is there's a lot of Puerto Ricans living in housing projects, and similarly in Bed-Stuy and in Harlem.
Yeah, I mean, one of the questions just to, you know, that people sometimes, or my students often ask, you know, is why does anybody come to New York? You know, the housing is so expensive here. You know, because even housing in neighborhoods that are not, you know, what people might not think are so desirable, their immigrants are paying really high rents. You know, we know they're living in basements in Queens. You know, so they are, you know, they're finding housing, but it's expensive. But I think Phil's right. I mean, I think there's going to be a push to move. They're going to have to, and find themselves moving further out in the kind of European, and less convenient, more expensive to commute, and still paying high prices because it's still, it's still going to be expensive. And in some cases, maybe needing a car, which is one of the big advantages of living in New York,
which
is not needing a car.
Forgive me if I miss this, but how are you defining an immigrant since we're all immigrants?
We're all immigrants?
Yeah. Well,
it's a person who was born in a foreign country and moves to New York.
That's a pretty good working definition.
we have, but I mean, that's...
So if you were born in a foreign country, you're an immigrant.
If you're born in the U.S., you are not an immigrant. And if you're born in Puerto Rico, you're not an immigrant either because you're a U.S. citizen at birth. So it also, that's...
I think it'd be more fascinating to ask, although we don't have time to answer it, how you would define an American.
Exactly.
But that's how, and actually a lot of the figures often say foreign-born. They don't use, they use foreign-born instead of immigrant. Peter, you want to give the legal definition.
I wanted to ask about the Jewish vote that you referred to, Mr. Roberts, and... you know, I don't believe had any Jews running for mayor this year in the primaries. Interesting.
Well, we did have
Anthony Weiner.
Oh, excuse me. How did I manage to get him? Okay, I'm embarrassed. Right. Oh, and we had Spitzer running.
Spitzer. Yeah, it wasn't a good year for the Jews.
I'm blocking as actively as I can.
And Scott Stringer. for control.
That's right.
Yeah, okay, but it seems that Jews are having less of a role. I wonder if you agree with that or not. And also that we have a lot of divisions among Jews in New York with, you know, the growth of the Orthodox, very different from the Reform or non-religious. Yeah. And, you know, what's the impact of all that?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I think it's funny what you said that because I was editing a book. I keep saying I'm editing a book, right? In which John Mulligoff wrote, this is the first election which there's no Jew running for mayor. And then he had to change that. That's why.
Then Wiener showed up.
Wiener showed up. And he had to revise that, right? So he did show up. And but Scott Stringer. But yes, Jews are, yes. I mean, who knows? Jews will still be running for office, I'm sure.
Yeah.
You know, and I think there won't only be appealing to Jews. they're not going to win if they just appeal to Jews, unless they're in some small part of New. And also, by the way, the Jewish vote is also. There's a lot of Russian Jewish. Right. To read the chapter in the book on Russian Jewish immigrants.
That's right.
By
I'm waiting
Annalise
for the Liberian.
Right.
The Liberian. Jewish
they're not right, but parts of Brooklyn. There are Jews running against Jews, and the ones actually, the ones who are former Soviet Jews, or they have an edge in certain kinds.
To some degree, the category is falling apart under its own complexity, in the sense that ultra-Orthodox groups and Hasidic groups don't tend to vote like other Jews, and so that's become a factor. Mm-hmm. Ironically, Thompson ended up taking a fair number, a large chunk of the Orthodox, more conservative Jewish vote. And of course, the Russians, who some of whom identify themselves as Jewish, some don't, but their immigration papers say they are. And so the boundaries there, I think, have become quite distinct. So there are a number of different Jewish votes at the moment. On the other hand, if you're voting in certain city council districts, it still becomes quite important.
Let's take one more question. Yes, sir.
Thank you. I was very interested in the various things you said about the black population in New York City. Early on, when you were talking about groups intermingling, you said the four main groups. You said the one group that's least likely to be mixing with other groups are still the African Americans and African populations and black Caribbean populations. Mm-hmm. You also pointed out, though, that certain areas are integrating, Harlem and Bed-Stuy. So what explains the difficulty of integration or the lack of integration for the black population in New York City compared to some of the others, given the actual, seems to me, complexity on the ground where we see areas where there is integration?
Well, I mean, prejudice, bottom line. I mean, we see this over and over again in neighborhoods in New York City. And West Indians are a really good example of this because they often try to move into white neighborhoods, seeking better schools, better housing, safer neighborhoods for their children. And they have often pioneered in these neighborhoods, it's been very difficult because it's tough being the first black family to move into a neighborhood. And what happens over and over again is no new white families move in, some whites move out, and the neighborhood seems to be more welcoming than to other blacks. And the neighborhood turns. I mean, for example, Canarsie is a perfect example of that. When I've studied West Indians. I remember studying West Indians and visiting them in their homes in the 80s. And the people would tell me, I was the first black family on the block. It's kind of uncomfortable. Canarsie is so heavily black now. Mm-hmm. So it seems to be that blacks have a great, and we know this is not just New York. This is elsewhere in the country, too, is that blacks seem to have a very great difficulty moving into integrated neighborhoods. Whites feel that, there have been so many studies of this, but whites feel a neighborhood is integrated if there's one black family. I'm exaggerating.
Right.
However, and then blacks feel it's integrated if it's half and half.
Right. There have been numerous polls on this, which is one of the great, an impossible paradox, that if you ask people, do you prefer a racially mixed neighborhood or a segregated neighborhood, a large majority of blacks and a not as large but substantial majority of whites say an integrated neighborhood. Mm-hmm. The integrated neighborhood whites have in mind is 10%, 10%. They want to be a 70% majority. The integrated neighborhood blacks have in mind is 50-50. So the moment that it gets to the point where blacks feel this is comfortable, whites are feeling uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. And so it's really quite the paradox. The new twist, of course, is the gentrification of certain historically black neighborhoods. How that's going to play out, we don't really know, because that's a very new thing. And one would, a cynic might say, well, that's, you know, a transitory thing until, you know, blacks become displaced. But the large amount of public housing in those neighborhoods means that's probably not going to happen. It also, by the way, I should note while I'm on my public housing kick, that to some degree makes the segregation figures a little exaggerated. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, since, to get overly technical about it, since public housing projects are almost all autonomous census tracts in the way it's figured, mm-hmm. sometimes when we talk about New York segregation, it looks extremely segregated, except it turns out that the people who are segregated from each other actually live very close together. Mm-hmm. You know,
across the street,
literally across the street, but because the housing project is an autonomous census tract, they may be sharing subway stations, they may be sharing commercial streets. So, you know, you have to be a little bit careful about that. But, you know, it is alarming to me the degree to which black-white segregation has sort of fallen off the political agenda. When was the last time a candidate of any, you know, party said what we really need is greater integration? Mm-hmm. And it's alarming to me the extent to which, for example, in issues of a school reform, there's kind of an acceptance of certain schools are going to be entirely this or entirely that. No matter what you think of them, you know, the charter school movement very often, you know, just assumes that certain schools will be entirely African American and let's make the best of it kind of thing. That's, we really have in that sense, it seems to me, gone very far backwards.
Thank you for coming. Nancy will be signing books. Thank you to Nancy and to Phil, and thanks to all of you.
All right, I'm taking this.